Hello everyone, it's Spawnpoint and welcome back to another video. So today we're going to be taking a look at something different, something that I use on a daily basis, which since picking up a few weeks ago has massively improved my productivity, and that's the Logitech MX Master 3 mouse and the MX Keys keyboard. Now, I was going to cover these in two separate videos, but honestly, they are so well matched with various crossover features that it makes more sense for me to talk about them both together. Just a quick note, and I've added timestamps to this video, so if you are only interested in one of the two items, you can jump to that section now. We'll take a look at the keyboard first, then the mouse, and then what they both share along with the setup instructions, customization, and my final verdict. So the MX range is available in two versions. There's the Mac-only option, where it'll only work on an Apple device, and then there's the cross-compatibility version, which will work on both Mac, Linux, and Windows. Now, as I use both Windows and Mac on a daily basis, I've opted for the latter, as it means that I only need one keyboard and mouse, and I'm able to use them on both systems at the press of a button. I'll show you how easy this is to swap between the two later. So first up, the keyboard, the MX Keys. So it retails for £99 or $99, and it seems to be one of the most popular keyboards on YouTube and Instagram at the moment, and there's a good reason for that. So what do you get in the box? Well, once you've removed the sleeve, you've got this nice black box with the MX branding on it. Then inside we've got a smaller box which contains a USB adapter, which you can use instead of Bluetooth, and then we've got the USB cable and some instructions, and that's pretty much it. For an extra £20 or $20, you can also get the Plus version. Now that comes with a palm rest, not something that I wanted, and if I did need a palm rest, I would probably go for a wooden one instead. So it's got a nice clean grey theme going on, with the frame having a gunmetal shade to it, which actually gives a nice contrast to the darker keys. It definitely has an Apple space grey look to it. The corners are rounded, which is pretty nice, so no sharp edges here at all. And it's got a clean logo and branding across the top too. Size-wise, I'd say it's pretty average. I mean, the dimensions are on screen here, so you can see for yourself. So it's not tiny like some of the small frame ones that I've seen out there, but it's not bulky either. It's pretty well balanced. But it feels heavy, and I mean, it weighs over 800 grams, so it feels solid. And handling it, there's no flex at all. Definitely feels premium rather than cheap plastic. It also doesn't show up any fingerprints at all. It looks clean pretty much all of the time. So it's got a full keyboard layout with a number pad on the side, which is always my preference. You can see that there are certain buttons that have dual purposes. So for example, the Alt key on Windows is the Command key on a Mac, and the same goes for the Options key and the Start buttons. So if you're switching between systems regularly, you'll obviously get used to this quite quickly anyway. And I don't feel like it takes anything away from the style here either. So for a cross-platform keyboard, it's done really, really well. Across the top, there are various function keys, including screen brightness, keyboard brightness, and your media playback options. You've also got a dedicated calculator and screenshot icon too. Then to switch between your different devices, you just tap the 1, 2, or 3, and it instantly swaps over. And something you'll notice are the small dips in the keys. And these are designed to match the shape of your fingertips. And this actually makes it a lot easier to type, because you can feel where your fingers are all the time. Talking about the keys, they are really sturdy too. So there's very little wobble or travel at all, and although it is a low profile keyboard, they aren't too thin that it feels uncomfortable, and your fingers won't slide or travel away from each key press. So as I mentioned, it's low profile, and it's got a kind of a tapered design. So at the base, it's very, very low, and I mean, it's almost as thick as a pen. Then at the top part, it's raised just enough so it's angled towards you. And to be honest, it's the perfect angle too. You can see underneath how it's raised with just this bar here, so it's not adjustable at all. There's also some small rubber feet, which does a great job at preventing any slips when you're using it. So the keypad is backlit, and it works really well too. So you can have it completely off if you need to, or you can adjust the brightness using the function keys across the top. It looks great at night. Now, unlike other keyboards that I've used, these don't stay on all the time. So they light up as you're typing, and after a second or two, they turn off again. But one really cool feature here is when your hand is approaching it, they light up. So you don't even need to touch the keys for them to light up, as shown here. And what's the battery life like? Well, it's really good. So it comes with an internal battery, so I'm not too sure how long it will take to actually charge from flat, but I can't imagine it taking longer than an hour or two. there is a battery indicator icon at the top of the keyboard, which will turn green when you first turn it on, and then it will blink red when it's flat. But the backlight will also turn off when it's below 10%. It'll last up to 5 months with the backlight turned off, or just 10 days with the backlight on. So if you want to last longer, definitely keep the lights off. There's a physical power button on the back as well, so when you're not using it, you can just switch it off knowing that it won't use any battery at all. And onto the MX Master 3 mouse, which also retails for £99 or $99. So what do you get in the box? And just like with the MX keys, once you've removed the sleeve, you've got this nice black box with the MX branding on it. And then again, we've got another USB adapter, a USB cable, and some instructions which you'll probably never read. So the MX Master 3 is available in mid-grey or graphite, so I've gone for the latter, and I think it matches the MX keys perfectly, and it has that space grey style to it, with the body of the mouse in a dark grey, similar to the keys on the keyboard, but it also has some lighter grey accents including the base and the scroll wheels. As for the texture, it feels rubbery and soft, not hard plastic like you'd usually get with a mouse, but again, at this price point, that's not a surprise. The corners are rounded, which is pretty nice again, so no sharp edges at all, and considering it's got quite an aggressive look, the rounded edges really do soften it. So an awesome looking mouse is great and all, but what does it feel like? Will it make a difference in terms of productivity? Well, the way that it's designed means it fits your hand almost perfectly. It has a thumb support, which means that your thumb isn't hovering or rubbing around on your mouse pad, and the shape allows your entire palm to hold it while you're using it. And it's pretty big. I mean, it's bigger than the previous Logitech mouses that I've had, but it weighs a lot less than I expected. It's nowhere near as solid or as heavy feeling as the MX keys. As mentioned earlier, it's made of a kind of a matte rubbery texture, which means your hand sticks to it and it feels comfortable too. It's also really, really precise and will work on any surface, even glass. So I've had no issues at all using it on my wood tabletop or my felt pad. So on the bottom, there's a button where you're able to swap between the different devices that you're using. Just tap it and tab through the different numbers. Then on the top, you've got your normal mouse buttons. You've got your left and your right click. You've also got your mode shift button on the top. Now this will actually toggle the scroll wheel between a ratchet and free spin mode, which I'll cover a little bit later as well. The scroll wheel can also be clicked too, which acts as a command or alt and right click, ideal for opening links and new tabs for example, but this can be customized. Then onto the side of the mouse where it gets interesting. So you've got a horizontal scroll wheel. Now this allows you to scroll obviously horizontally, and depending on the app that you're using will have a different function. So for example, if I'm using Audacity, which is what I'm using now to record this video in audio, then I'm able to scroll left and right on the timeline without having to actually drag the mouse itself. And the same applies to, say, Final Cut Pro. You can navigate horizontally through the timeline just by using this scroll wheel. You've then got a forwards and backwards button, great for navigating web pages, and again this can be customized to maybe do undo and redo. And finally we've got the gesture button. So the gesture button is designed to be pressed, followed by a movement of the mouse itself. So by default, you would hold the gesture button, and then by swiping up will open task view or mission control on a Mac, and pressing the gesture button and swiping down will reveal all of the apps or windows that you currently have open. But this can be customized again, which I will show later. Okay, so the scroll wheel on this is actually incredible, to the point that it's a game changer for productivity. Not only does it feel awesome to use, but because it's using electromagnetics to provide a super smooth glide, it's also really fast and it's really quiet too. So when you're scrolling, it will free spin if you let it. Just one quick spin and it's away, to the point where it will scroll thousands of lines of code or hundreds of pages in a matter of seconds. But it's really responsive too, so it's responsive enough to stop as soon as you touch it. And the battery life again is really, really impressive. So it's got a built-in rechargeable battery as you would expect. And Logitech predicts that a quick 1 minute charge will actually last you 3 hours of use, which obviously is really useful if you've run it completely flat, but you need it immediately. Now a full charge will last you around 70 days or over 1,600 hours, which is incredible. On the bottom, there's a physical button to power it off too. So when you're not using it, you can switch it off knowing that you're not using any battery at all. And I literally do this every single night. Now this is what really sets this combo apart from the rest, and that's the customization that you're able to do. So Logitech recommends installing their software, Logi Options, and this allows you to customize every function button on the keyboard and the gesture controls on the mouse, as well as some of the buttons as well. So every function key across the top can have multiple purposes, and you can use the default settings, or you can change each button to do any task or open any application that you want. So for example, you could have F1 open Photoshop, or F2 could be your desktop. Almost anything is possible here, and the same goes for the mouse. So you can change what each button does, or what each gesture does as well. So for example, you could press the gesture button, you could swipe down, and you could reveal your desktop. So I would definitely recommend downloading and installing this, whether you're using Mac or Windows. It's pretty straightforward, but as you can see, you can make changes and create shortcuts that will make your life that little bit easier. This can totally transform the way you work by using gestures to complete certain tasks that you'd usually use shortcuts for. And if you regularly open certain apps, the function keys can be mapped to save you time too. So what's great about this range is the fact that it will work on both Windows and Mac, which is ideal for me, as I've said before. But it also means it'll work across multiple devices. So for example, you could use them on your iPhone, your iPad, your MacBook, your Windows laptop. All you need to do is pair each device to a number on the keyboard and mouse. And then once paired, every time you press the number 1, 2 or 3, it will just swap between each device. So the MX range uses Bluetooth to connect. And as most devices have Bluetooth by default, you shouldn't have any issues. But if yours doesn't, it does come with the USB dongle, and that allows you to plug that in and connect that way instead. You'll only need one adapter for the pair though, so although they come with one each, you won't need to install them both. So they both come with USB cables, which you can plug into your machine or a USB plug if you have one to charge. And this is where the ports are for both, so you're still able to use the devices while you're charging too. Okay, so let's take a look at how you set them up. Now this is really, really easy. So the first thing you need to do is head over to the MX setup website, and it will talk you through what you need to do. But essentially, you power on the keyboard and mouse, you press and hold the key that you wish to pair it to until it starts to blink fast. It'll then show up as a Bluetooth device on your machine, and then you just press connect. For the keyboard, you will need to type the code in on screen into your new keyboard, and this will then pair the two together. So together, they do make the perfect combo. With the overall look and professional styling, along with the incredible customization you're able to do, this pair makes the ultimate productivity duo. I'm really pleased I opted for this, and to be honest, unless I was going for a mechanical keyboard, there isn't really any other combo that I would go for. Sure, you've got the Logitech Craft, which is practically the same as the MX keys, but with a scroll wheel, but that's £80 or $80 more. So for £200 or $200, it seems like a lot of money to spend on a keyboard and mouse. I mean, you can pick up other combo kits for as little as £30 or $30, but honestly, it's worth it. I'd highly recommend getting them if you're in need of a new stylish, sleek, and productivity-driven keyboard and mouse. But what do you think? Do you think it's worth $200 or £200? Do you think you could justify spending that on a keyboard and mouse? Let me know in the comments. And that wraps up this week's video, so I know it's different to something that I would usually create, but if you've got any questions at all or suggestions for a new video, just drop them in the comments below. So as always, thank you for watching. And if this video was useful to you or you're interested in seeing more tech videos, please don't forget to like and subscribe. You can also follow me on my other social channels, including Instagram and Twitter. Until next time.